English language has so overwhelmed them that they're beginning to lose their ancestral languages. So they have to work really hard and get young people like you to be enthusiastic about recovering what is being lost. Well, that's been our story. That is our story. For 2,000 years, we endured a bitter exile, but we never lost the connection. Shabbat Shalom, everybody. We're going to do a Devar Torah now, and you need to have, if you don't mind, your Chumash, the five books of Moses. It's also a blue book, maybe an unfortunate coincidence that the two synagogue volumes are both in the same color. Makes it hard for us. You know, sometimes we don't see stuff that's right in front of us. And we don't see it, if we ever did, because we see it all the time. In other words, there's no contrast. That's why it's such an important button on our TV. We need that contrast. We need to see the difference, highlight, the way things stand out or are submerged. That gives us texture and context for things so that we can better understand what they're trying to do. And frankly, that's my big complaint about this week's Torah. It wasn't designed this way. In fact, it does provide the contrast. But when we read this Torah portion on Rosh Hashanah, we only get part of the story. Now, if I've confused you sufficiently, I hope I have, then you'll be motivated to be unconfused because you have a curious mind. A curious mind wants resolution. That's what pushes us forward. That's what pushes everyone forward. We may even go to Mars in the next decade or so. And believe me, it will be mostly because we are curious. So let's look on page 135. 135. And there you will have one of the worst stories in the entire Bible. Now, all the children, we programmed them to stand up here when they knew their Bar Mitzvahs and say, I have the best Torah portion, my Torah. This is the worst. And it's the worst because it raises questions about our faith and about human nature that we don't want to ask. And we certainly don't want to answer. So let's look. Have I got your attention so far? I guess not. Oh, there we go. On 135, I need some readers. I need some helpers. You don't have a whole bunch in front of you. No. Okay, grandfather. See, grandfathers go first. On 135, chapter 22, verse 1, after these things. Wait, read it more slowly. Oh, there you go. They're different between treated and tested. He tested him and he said, that's terrible. Right? You like that? No. And anybody who's a parent, anybody who cares about family, this is just the most horrible thing. So we can impute from this story that Abraham is a sycophant. He does what God wants him to do. His chief quality is that of being obedient, which is perhaps good in an assistant, but maybe not so good in a leader. So remember I told you we need a contrast. So now let's look for some contrast. Do you know where to find it, by the way? let's see if we can come up with some contrast. Now, in the biblical story of Abraham, he comes to a place that's called Sodom. How do we pronounce that in English? Is that a nice, is that where you want to go in a ski and sun vacation? Is that a nice place? You want to, you're going to be well received? I just got back from Peru. There were very nice people there. How are these Sodom people? Are they lovely? Yeah? Are they? Yes or no?
No.
Let's look at 1:2:4. 1:2:4. 1:2:4 in the same parasha. Do we ever read this story on Rosh Hashanah? No, we read the one we just started with, the Akedat Yitzchak. Are you there? Indicate that you're still breathing. All right, that's good. On verse 16, who would like to read there? Okay, Teresa. All right, just stop, because those men are the angelic beings that came in the previous chapter to tell Abraham and Sarah that they were going to have Isaac. Okay, so that's the connecting. That's the connecting verse. Then, does Abraham know these fellows? Not really, but he's extremely, extremely solicitous of them. And when they leave, he walks them out. That's even today a politeness that we still, in some quarters, retain. And rather than just saying, hey, there's the door, hit it, we walk our guests to the door. And then what happens to me, sir? Should I hide from Abraham what I am doing? So our biblical author tells us what God's internal thoughts are. God's internal thoughts are given to us by the Torah. Carry on, we're doing extremely well to us. Okay, 19.
For I have selected him so that he may teach the children and those who come after him to keep away from eternal, doing what is right and just, so that the eternal will be fulfilled for Abraham all that has been promised.
This is a big speech, and it tells us something about what the expectations are. Randy could write the curriculum for the whole religious school based on this pasuk. What is the job, according to this Torah passage, of the Jewish people? To do what? No, not to teach them. If you get that in kindergarten, you learn A, B, C, D. That's just a means to an end. What's the outcome that is expected? No, not to be a great and prosperous nation. The Chinese have succeeded, we have failed. That is not our distinction. They even have better food than us. What is the purpose of the Jewish people according to this verse? It doesn't say Tikkun Olam. What does it say? I want to hear what's in the verse. Huh? Righteousness. That's the purpose. All the other stuff is a means to an end. It is a tactic. It is not a strategy. Where was I? Teresa. Their cry is great because there's such injustice. Their crimes are heinous. Should I not tell Abraham what I'm about to do? Who's our next reader? There's a little echo. Yes, Marsha. Did it in Marshall. Boring. reason why I corrected Stephen, that he said, we don't read the Torah. We do not read the Torah. We only lay the Torah. We stand. We learn it. Because until you can see the whole picture in its complexity and sometimes in its incomprehensibility, the contradictions that it contains, we cannot draw out of it with the aid of our very long literary tradition, its real meaning. And when we come to the story of the sacrifice of Isaac, I want to remind you that this story is not really a story of obedience. Because the way the story is framed. So let's look at it one more time, Stephen. You get to reprise your performance.
Dia Marti, 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 D
Christina and Ben, you now have the unique one-time-in-your-life opportunity to pronounce your son potentially morally responsible for his abuse. Just repeat after me. Baruch. Shapatarani. Me'onesh. Shalazeh. Praise are you, O God, who has implanted within this young person the potential for Jewish moral discernment. Say amen.
Amen.
Rebecca Cohen, Karen Cohen, Robert Cohen.